All right, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to another live edition of Eye on the Community, and I'm your host, Sean Anthony, and today I'm honored to have this beautiful young lady on the show today, the CEO of PrimaryOne Health, Ms. Charleta Tavares. How art thou?
I am doing fine, Sean. It's good to see you.
Likewise, good to see you as well. You know, we're going to talk about something very controversial and very topical right now. And of course, you know, we've all had to adjust our lives to this pandemic, the COVID-19 coronavirus. Before we get into that, though, I want to talk a little bit. I want you to share with our listeners your role at PrimaryOne Health.
Well, I'm the Chief Executive Officer of PrimaryOne Health. And so I oversee the operations of the organizations, our clinical operations, our administrative operations, and to really work with our board of directors. 51% of our board of directors, by the way, have to be patients of our health center. That's a requirement in order to be a federally qualified health center. You want to make sure you're taking the direction, you're getting the perspectives, and they're giving the guidance to the organizations. Those that you serve are basically sharing what kind of services they want, where they want the services, and the times of day that they want the services.
That's interesting. I didn't know that. That's good to know. When the onset of this COVID-19 coronavirus started to, you know, hit all the parts, of course, of the globe, but especially in America and primarily here in Central Ohio, what was the biggest adjustment for you guys at PrimaryOne Health?
The biggest adjustment was to try and pivot from the kinds of services, face-to-face services, because remember, in the early months of the pandemic, there was a lot of fear. Patients didn't want to come in because they didn't want to be close to practitioners or other patients. Practitioners and clinicians and staff didn't want to be close to patients. We were still trying to figure out the best social distancing of our staff within each of our health center sites, as well as how we ensure that we have enough personal protective equipment or PPE for our staff, as well as our patients that are walking in our doors. And so we had to pivot to do telehealth. That's not a form of health visits that we had the opportunity to enjoy prior to the pandemic. Federally qualified health centers had to have their patient and their practitioner, doctor, or nurse in one of our health center sites. They could use the phone or an electronic, tablet or computer, but both the doctor and the patient or the nurse had to be in one of our facilities, which kind of takes away from what a telehealth visit is supposed to be about. It's supposed to be about convenience for those who may be sick or frail and can't come in, or if you have a practitioner who is at another location or may need to work from an office.
Yeah.
So that really changed the way we delivered healthcare for a long period of time. We were seeing mostly our patients via one of those telephonic or tablet visits.
How effective has that been? Because I know we've all had to pivot, like you said, and it's become a more virtual world now where we are relying on this type of communication. Normally we would be in the studio doing this radio interview. How impactful has that been, you know, not so much for the doctors, but for the patients?
It's been a little challenging for some of our patients that speak a language, a primary language other than English, and for our older adult patients, many who are not technology proficient. For some of our cultures, racial and ethnic and cultural communities, they want to see and have their physician or nurse practitioner or behavioral health clinician see them in person, touch them, and to look in their eyes to know that there's some rapport and that the fear of who else is looking at me through this electronic mechanism, when they can't see who else might be in the room, there's a little fear. And so in some cases, our patients have said they would rather wait than to use the telehealth model. They'd rather wait until face-to-face visits are open. And so we've had to adjust to that too. We are bringing more of our clinicians back into the health center sites. We have 12 sites, but right now we're only operating 8 of them because we want to make sure we're socially distancing folks. And as we get more face-to-face visits, we will open more sites as more of our staff come back into the office, because we've been impacted by childcare issues, school issues, where a lot of our staff are single heads of household women who have to stay home with their children. And so not only have we been impacted by our patients been impacted, but our staff have been impacted as well.
Now let's talk about this vaccine. We're constantly hearing lots of reports all in the media and everything, but as it pertains to Columbus, Ohio, let's talk about eligibility. Who's eligible to get the vaccine right now at this moment?
Starting this week, today, those that are 70 years of age and older are eligible. This is the 1B category, and we're now at the 70 years of age and older. Those that were in the 1A category, which were first responders, healthcare workers, and others, they can still get the vaccine. Those that may have waited for whatever reason, they may now want to get the vaccine. So they're eligible. And those with congenital disabilities or illnesses and diseases that make them more vulnerable, if they're 70 years of age, and in some cases, if they're less than 70 years of age. But mainly, it's going to be those 70 years of age and older. We know with our health center itself, at the 80 years of age and older, we had 671 patients. For those 75 and older, it was over 5,500 patients. So we've got very few vaccines at this point, and we want to make sure we're opening it not only to our patients, but also to the general public.
Which leads into my next question, Charleta. Will everyone who wants to get a vaccine be able to get one? Because I have a couple of relatives that, you know, are a little older, an uncle of mine. He said, look, nephew, when that vaccine comes out, I want to get it. You know, can yes. anybody that wants to get it, can they get it, and how?
They will be able to get it at some point in time. We're still waiting on more vaccines to come in from the federal government. I think, as you've heard, Sean, what we thought was a stockpile in DC didn't exist. The previous administration said that there was a stockpile of vaccines. And what we know now is that there wasn't a stockpile.
Oh, wow.
And so the manufacturers, the pharmaceutical companies that are making Moderna and Pfizer, Johnson & Johnson, which hasn't gotten its approval yet, but we look for that probably this week, that they are manufacturing as much of the vaccine as they possibly can so that we can get more of it out into the communities. But we know that probably by summer, most of the people who want to get the vaccine will be able to get it by then. We're going to take people in those age cohorts so that we don't have a run on health centers, hospitals, et cetera. At this point in time, there is limited supply that's coming out to hospitals, health centers, and private practitioners' offices. Pharmacies also are getting limited supplies. Last week, we vaccinated about 324 individuals. And that's, you know, much less than we had anticipated, but still we're grateful that we were able to get 324 individuals vaccinated last week.
Charleta, real quick, out of that 324, do you know that were those people in the healthcare field, or were these elderly people? Like what demographic were these?
Yeah, these were those that at that point were 75 years of age and older. We also ask people to go online when our vaccines are open and when we have appointment slots available. We put up that link on our website at www.primaryonehealth.org. We also have the ability for people to text the word vaccine, V-A-C-C-I-N-E, to 614-502-5329, and they will be given a link so that they can sign up if they're 70 years of age and older this week for appointments. And then we have a wait list for those that might not have been able to get an appointment, that they can go on the list, because sometimes at the end of the day, if people didn't show up for their appointment, there are vaccines left and we don't want any of the vaccines to go to waste. And so we might call you and say, you have to be here within an hour, because once you open the vial, you have 6 hours to get those vaccinations out of that vial administered. Once the syringe is filled, you have an hour. So we may call you and say, we need you here within the next hour, or we need you here within the next 2 hours. And so that's why we have a wait list.
That's interesting. I don't know if you heard on the news recently, there was a refrigerator unit that broke somewhere, I think on the West Coast, and they put a call out to the public, say, look, you know, we got to get these vaccines out. That's interesting to know. Obviously, it has to be kept at a certain temperature, right?
Absolutely. That's exactly right. And we're hoping that the Johnson & Johnson vaccine that we hope will be approved for emergency distribution this week, that's a one-shot vaccination, where Moderna and Pfizer at this point are two shots. Right. So you have to come back. We give you an appointment to come back to get your booster or your second shot.
What's the time limit in between that first?
About 21 days.
Oh, okay. Okay. Wow. So that brings another question about the supply and demand with those second doses. I mean, is it, you know, do you have certain amounts set aside for people that already have the first dose?
No, we use the vaccines that we have at that point in time. We have been assured that based on the numbers that we submit, those numbers to the State Department of Health, that we will get the doses to give those second shots.
I got to be honest with you. This is really interesting information, Charleta, because I do quite a bit of reading and researching and things like that. And, you know, it's one thing, you know, reading articles from certain journalists and things like that, but talking to someone who's in this industry gives me insight and perspective, which is why we're having this interview, right?
Absolutely. And we appreciate that you and the station are doing this to share factual information with individuals in our community, and especially Black and brown communities.
Absolutely. So PrimaryOne Health, you guys obviously are a distribution center for the vaccines. How did you guys get into that role, and why is it important for PrimaryOne Health to be a vaccine distribution site?
Well, we got into it because we're in the healthcare business. We want to keep people healthy, and because we have a partnership with the federal government. We were created by the federal government in 1965 with the war on poverty. FQHCs, federally qualified health centers, were created back in 1965. And Sean, what many people don't know, and this is Black History Month, this form, this model of healthcare was brought to America from South Africa. So the villages in South Africa created this form of healthcare delivery, neighborhood-based healthcare delivery, meeting the needs of the patients and providing the services for the patients in that geographic community. And so two physicians brought it back to America and started this in 1965. So we're fortunate, and we focused our services on vulnerable populations, racial, ethnic, and cultural communities that have barriers to receiving healthcare. The first ones in America were in Mississippi and Boston. And so we've grown from there, from those two health centers in 1965, to over 1,300 throughout the country with multiple sites. Like, we have 12 sites. We're one health center with 12 sites. And many of the others have 3, 4, 25 sites. And so there are multiple FQHC sites around America to serve vulnerable populations, homeless populations, uninsured, underinsured, and insured patients who have barriers to healthcare.
Interesting. All right. Now, a lot of people are skeptical about vaccines, period. You know, you have anti-vaxxers and you got people that are pro-vaccines. Set that aside. This COVID-19 vaccine has been developed with under a year, and rightfully so. A lot of people are cautious and skeptical. Can you provide some sort of insight, perspective that could calm some of those skeptics out there, including myself? I'll be completely transparent with you. I have concerns about it. It sounds like it was rushed. Can you talk to myself and the listeners about that?
Sure. And I think many people have been a little concerned because the observation from those of us on the outside of the research world believe that it has started from scratch in 2020. However, it is a variation of other viruses. And so there's already been study, there's already been vaccines of other viruses that are a variant of COVID-19. So this is another form of a virus in the same family. And so research has been done throughout the years. They have worked together, and I do have to give federal researchers, federal departments like the CDC and the FDA and others working, and the National Institutes of Health working closely with the pharmaceutical companies to come up with a vaccine that works for this coronavirus, so that it kills it, but more importantly, stops the spread. I think one of the things that we all need to be concerned about is that we're getting accurate information. Just as you said, there are a lot of people on the internet, whether it's on Twitter or Facebook or Instagram, any of the places on social media where people are sharing their own information, right, not factual information, not accurate information. What I encourage everyone, and especially racial, ethnic, and cultural communities, is to do your research with credible sources like the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, the CDC, like the National Institutes of Health, like the Ohio Department of Health and the Columbus Public Health and Franklin County Public Health. Look at their websites and then look at some of the credible African-American physician organizations like the National Medical Association, where our own Dr. Leon McDougall is the president of the national organization. And he and a group of African-American organizations are developing information for their websites and to share with others on how you look for the credible information, dispelling myths, so that African-Americans who have been a little suspect on research and trials because of some negative experiments in the past can get that information that is factual and credible.
Does the vaccine give you COVID?
No, the vaccine does not give you COVID. It doesn't have the coronavirus in the vaccine itself.
Okay. You kind of answered this, but is it safe and effective? I mean, to kind of calm some of the fears that's out there that's, you know, because you hear the reports of the adverse reactions. And obviously, you know, outside of the COVID-19 vaccine, any other vaccine, some people have reactions to that. Can you speak on that?
Sure. As you know, I'm not an expert on research. However, every vaccine could have a reaction. Some people could have a reaction. I mean, we hear those commercials on television all the time of new pharmaceutical products. Right. And believe me, all of the cautions and all of the side effects that they have to list in those commercials are generally longer than the commercial itself.
Right.
But with the COVID-19 vaccine, there have been very few side effects that have come forth. One is for those who have asthma, they may experience some breathing difficulties. And that's why when you get the vaccine, you are monitored for 15 to 30 minutes. 15 minutes if you don't have asthma or any allergies that have brought on breathing difficulties in the past. 30 minutes if you have asthma or you've had anaphylactic shock or gone into breathing challenges. So that we make sure while you're sitting there after you've had the vaccine that you're okay to take off. Whether it's in a drive-through like we had last week, we had a drive-through vaccine shots on Tuesday, and then on Thursday, we had an inside vaccine shots. We had the people either pull their cars over to the side and we had medics go in and monitor them and let them know when their 15 or 30 minutes was up, or if they were inside the building, then they were sequestered in another part of the facility so that we could monitor them to make sure that they were okay to go on. But there have been very few side effects that have been brought forth, but that's natural with any drug or any medication that's given. Some people will react differently than others.
Charleta, before we wrap up, what is your perspective, from your view, on the vaccine being rolled out? Are you seeing people, you know, more receptive, excited, or you know, like in your realm and in the people that you interact with? What kind of
I'm seeing that the majority of the people do want the vaccine. And in fact, I've gotten calls from many people wanting to know if they're eligible to get the vaccine or not. I encourage them to not only do their own due diligence and look at credible sources, but also to talk to their nurse practitioner or physician so that they can make the decision that's best for them as an individual patient, because all of us are different. But I'm seeing the vast majority of people wanting to get the vaccine. Some are hesitant at first and they're waiting to see how friends and family and members of their community react. And then some just want to study a little bit more before they get the vaccine. But I think all in all, people are anxious, and particularly for those with compromised immune systems, those with comorbidities or underlying health conditions like heart disease or cancer, or individuals who have diabetes or hypertension, that they're a little more concerned about their health. And not getting the vaccine might make them more susceptible and or have much, much harder or more drastic symptoms.
Gotcha. Well, Charleta, I definitely appreciate your time. Thank you so much for joining us and sharing this information. The CEO of Primary One Health, Charleta Tavares, thank you so much.
Thank you, Sean. And thank you for your audience. And hopefully we can save some lives.
Absolutely. You be safe and talk to you soon.
You too. Bye-bye.
Bye.